Jesus' name, to love and serve the Lord. Anointed by the Spirit's flame, to love and serve the Lord. If we live...
Tony, our guest tonight, we are just so thrilled. We're enthralled the fact that he is going to give a little bit of his time while he's here in Pittsburgh this weekend to us. If you don't know Tony, Tony is one of the most talented, prolific young composers of Catholic liturgical music. He was dubbed the voice of a new generation in church music and has shared his musical gifts as well as his love and knowledge of liturgy at many conferences and events across the United States and Canada. For those of you that will be attending the NPM convention in July in Raleigh, North Carolina, you'll see Tony there. Composing in both English and Spanish, his music reflects the multicultural needs of the contemporary church, as well as a strong commitment to ritual music. Tony currently serves as a professor of theology at Emory University in Atlanta, Georgia. And I'm sure he can tell us a little bit more about that position that he is currently in. So please join me in giving a big Pittsburgh welcome to Dr. Tony Alonso.
Thank you all so much. I'm actually in town for the Catholic Theological Society of America conference, which begins tomorrow, a big gathering of Catholic nerds who will share, even nerdier than us. Takes it to a whole new level, where we'll share academic papers and wrestle with all kinds of issues. And through the grapevine, I got this wonderful invitation to join you to kind of tag this onto this trip. It's my delight to be here. I know that here in Pittsburgh, as in so many places across the country and indeed the world, this is a difficult time for the church. It is a time of woundedness and of pain. I have a deep belief that if there's anything Christians are trained in, it's in looking for life where others can only see death. That is at the heart of our faith. And so I'm grateful for those of you who continue to endure in this work and trusting in its continued growth and development, even when it seems dark and bleak. And so I'm grateful for that. I'm going to offer a reflection this evening on the Psalms. And as I was looking through the packet of music that I asked GA to send, I saw the song Come Holy Ghost in there, an arrangement I had done. And I have no earthly idea why in the workshop of the Psalms I included that in the packet. I was like, what is this doing here? And so I thought it would be a great song to start with, since I have nothing else to do with it. And because you all know it, Pentecost must have been on my mind, because that's the liturgy we're celebrating, of course, this weekend. This is from a collection of contemporary arrangements of traditional hymns that I did recently. I love so many of these traditional hymns, and I find that people with guitars and pianos tend to avoid them because they don't know what to do with them. And so I tried to write arrangements for that. So let's sing this together. We'll sing the first verse in unison. The second and third verses, we'll go ahead and segregate the parts. If you sing something different, we'll just call that extended harmony. And then we'll do the optional final verse with the descant. So please rise in body or spirit and let us sing together.
Thank you.
of love my shepherd is. It's the other octavo you have there from that same collection. That was much faster than the organist of my childhood. That's all. I'll just call out what we're going to do as we go along, because it's six verses long, and you and I will not remember what I said at the beginning of the song. If y'all are going to be at NPM this summer in Raleigh, we're going to do two nights of beer and hymns. We're going to sing a bunch of old hymns in contemporary ways and drink, and you can drink other things than beer if you don't want it. I find that two of the favorite things of NPMers is to drink and to sing. And so I just decided, let's give the people what they want. For most Catholics, perhaps especially for those of us who serve as music ministers, when we hear the psalm, the first thing that jumps into our mind is probably the responsorial psalm, what we sing between the first and the second reading at Mass. That is, we think of the psalms as they appear in the lectionary. most often with a refrain intoned by a cantor, repeated by all or not. And then a cantor singing the verses interspersed with that same refrain sung by all. And much of our time this evening will be spent on that particular usage of the Psalms. But I want to spend the first chunk of our evening thinking with you more broadly about the biblical book of Psalms and its role in the life of the church and its role in the life of each one of us. Psalms are, of course, not only that song we sing between the two readings. They are the most ancient prayers of both the Jewish and the Christian traditions. As musicians and as servants of the liturgy, it is our book in a very privileged way. The Hebrew name for the book of Psalms literally means a book of praises. And on the surface, a book of praises seems like a peculiar name for the book of Psalms because, believe it or not, there are actually many more laments in the book of Psalms than any other type of psalm. When we think of praising God, we might think of something like Psalm 150, the last psalm. Praise God in his holy place. Praise him in his mighty firmament. Praise him for his powerful deeds. Praise him with his boundless grandeur. Oh, praise him with the sound of the trumpet. That's the original praise and worship psalm. Praise, praise, praise. It's not hard to hear the energy of that psalm and the repetition of the word praise so many times paired with joy. But what about Psalm 44? Now you have rejected us, disgraced us. You no longer go forth with our armies. You make us retreat from the foe. Those who hate us plunder us at will. You make us the taunt of our neighbors, the mockery and scorn of all around us. Can we call this praise as well? I don't know about you, but those words don't sound much like praise to me at first hearing. But for the ancient Hebrews, the answer to the question of whether this too is a prayer of praise is unequivocally yes. And if we're attentive to the richness of the Hebrew tradition, we get a profound sense of why even our deepest lament, our anger, our rage can fit under the title Book of Praises. For ancient Hebrews, any words directed toward God, from deepest joy to most profound sorrow at the state of the world around them, were considered praise. Let me say that again, because I think it's pretty radical and deserving of our attention. Any words directed toward God are words of praise. This, to me, is such a powerful way to think about praise. One, it seems to me, we have sometimes neglected in our use of the Psalms, tending toward Psalms that offer words of confidence or comfort, but sometimes shying away from the tougher words of the Psalms. Although we Christians often speak of our deep intimacy and love of God, we sometimes think anything short of complimenting God for God's goodness is not actually praise. But if we take seriously the book of Psalms, we can see that it gives us a vocabulary much richer than we can ever ask or imagine to cry out to God in every season of life, especially the hard seasons of life, and still call it praise. So why is this the case? Why can even our deepest pain be a source of our deepest praise? Well, I think one helpful way to think about it is to think of a deeply intimate relationship in your life, perhaps the most intimate relationship in your life with another human, perhaps a spouse or a child or a parent. In those relationships we call the most intimate, we don't merely sit around praising the other person for all of his or her good qualities, although some of our partners might wish we knew more of that. Now, not that that isn't a part of those relationships, but praising the goodness of another just doesn't exhaust all those things the relationship needs in our lives. In the relationships most dear to us, we don't simply compliment. We enter into deep, honest, soul-bearing dialogue about all we are, all we fear, all that breaks our heart, all that causes us anger and pain. They are the arms we fall into in moments of despair as well as in moments of joy. They are the people we argue with when we feel wronged or hurt because we want to transform that hurt and restore peace. We long for reconciliation in those relationships closest to us when they falter. You see, our willingness to share our deepest pain with each other is a sign of our willingness to show our deepest vulnerability to them. Expressing our sufferings and pains reveals the intimacy of our relationships. It reveals to the others that we love them, that we trust them, that we still come back to them even when we are in pain. It is a commitment to not cutting them off, even when it might be easier to just do that. And so if this is true of the most intimate relationships of our lives with our spouses, our children, our parents, how much more it should be with God? If we are to be honest, authentic, and naked before God, in order to pray the joy of Psalm 150 authentically, we must also be willing to pray the pain of Psalm 44. When we turn to God with our doubts and our questions and our fears, we reveal to God our trust that only God can transform our present situation. When we ask for something out of vulnerability, we honor God, we praise God. Even our anger, the Hebrew scriptures testify to this in a profound way. Even our anger can, in a rich sense, be praise because it means we are still in dialogue, that we still trust despite present trials. Just as in a marriage or a lifelong friendship, the commitment to the other is abandoned only when we no longer go to the other person to reconcile, when we refuse to express even our anger or disappointment, when we close ourselves off, so it is with God. But when we stay in dialogue, even when the dialogue is filled with pain or tears or fears, we reveal our deepest love of a God who Psalm 139 tells us knows when we sit, when we stand, who discerns our purpose from afar. There's nowhere we can hide anyway, so we may as well be honest about it. The book of Psalms is also a reminder that to be in relationship with God is rich, complex, and worthy of our whole beings, not just our happy moments. Indeed, I don't know about you, but for me, sharing the good things that happen in my life, like getting a new job or receiving some kind of an honor or achievement, is much easier for me to share, especially on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter, than it is for me to share my heartbreak and my pain, my failures and my disappointments. But the Psalms remind me that God not only can handle both, but God deserves both. We reveal our commitment to God through our willingness to share it all. And so, like the ancient Hebrews, any words directed toward God can be gifts of praise. The Psalms are the prayer book of the Bible, and they are the prayers of all of the people in the Bible. Do you notice this when you listen to the scriptures? You hear little phrases of psalms that you know from singing them over the course of many lectionary years. You hear them appearing in the first reading or the second reading or the gospel. You hear them in the lips of Jesus on the cross. You hear them all over the place. They are the prayer book of the people in the Bible. They're the prayers which emerged in response to a wide array of biblical stories and situations in the Old Testament. Whenever God seemed active in the life of the people, but especially when God seemed distant or absent from the life of the people, prophets and ordinary people alike turned to the Psalms and seem to have broken into song. Some of the prayers that make up the book of Psalms are those of an individual. Some are those of a community. After conflicts with adversaries, individuals or communities gave gratitude for land restored, for the restoration of peace shattered by war and violence. Some psalms tell of the wisdom of the elders of the community, like Psalm 1. Happy are they who follow the Lord. I always, whenever I sing Psalm 1, I think of my grandmother, telling how a life should be lived and offering warnings about what the consequences will be if we don't follow the path. Other psalms, like Psalm 8, how great is your name in all the earth, express awe for the wonder of God's creation and the rhythm of the seasons. And still others give voice to the pain and pathos of human experience, all the intrigue of a telenovela, betrayal, deception, reconciliation, gratitude, joy, it's all there. And still others give voice, in other words, they are the prayers handed down from generation to generation that speak not only of God's work in history, but God's activity even now. And so when we pray the Psalms in the liturgy, but also in our daily lives, they link us with a long line of faithful people who had these words etched on the depths of their hearts and on their lips to sing God's praise in all its height, length, breadth, and depth. I mentioned earlier, do you remember what I said that the most common form of psalm is in the book of Psalms? Lament, yeah. And you might wonder why that's the case. Why does lament appear so many times in the book of Psalms? And it's in part because so many of the people praying these prayers in their original incarnation were largely a powerless people, powerless in their own context by any standard we might use to judge worldly power today. Like so many of the tear-soaked pages of the Hebrew Scriptures, the words we hear are often the words of a weak and wounded people. And how important it is for us to keep that in mind when we pray those words. When we hear words of anger and wrath, of people asking God to defeat the enemy, they might make us rightly uncomfortable. Some may even resist many of the psalms precisely in light of some of this language, opting only for the pretty sounding ones. And from the perspective of any of us who hold power, whether in the world or in our communities, much of it should cause us discomfort, because these words sound very different from the mouth of the powerful than they do from the mouth of the weak. For someone without power to say, our God is a God of war, is very different than someone with considerable power and military might. And without minimizing our own collective and personal sufferings, we must confess that most of us live in relative privilege relative to the kind of suffering we're talking about in the Hebrew Scriptures. Individual lament is so central to the Psalms because of the deep suffering of Israelite society. Disease ravaged people, killing thousands, constant daily threats from enemies, loss of property, the remarkable success of those who oppressed them. These are some of the daily experiences of those crying out to God in the Psalms for deliverance. The economy promoted by the kings in ancient Israel essentially sought to literally exterminate the population, leaving people impoverished and suffering. Losing one's land and one's livelihood has psychological effects, not just physical ones. And so the Psalms are first and foremost the songs of those people, losing property and possession of their families for generations, the only way they had a chance at survival. The wealthy and the powerful seized this land and created large estates for themselves. And so this social context helps us understand why the Book of Praises so much lament. People had nowhere to turn but their God. The world had completely let them And so they turn to God. They turn to God to express their protests and their longing for liberation from oppression and misery in their public and private worship. Maybe you already hear some resonances in your own lives, in your own communities, in our whole shared world. The Psalms remind us that when our social, our political, and even our ecclesial structures let us down, we can and should find an outlet for our grief through our prayer and ritual. But if we pray some of the more difficult Psalms without any context, we can mistakenly read them as the Psalms of the powerful. We might ask ourselves at times, especially in our privilege compared to the rest of the world, what does it mean to pray the prayers of the oppressed when we ourselves are not oppressed in the same ways? Perhaps part of our prayer when we come across those Psalms that cause us discomfort or make us wish we were saying, "The Lord is my light and my salvation," is to pray them in solidarity with those who we know are suffering across the world. Dietrich Bonhoeffer reminds us of this so well when he writes the following: "All of the things of which the Psalter speaks, which individuals can never fully comprehend and call their own, live only in the whole Christ. That is why the prayer of the Psalms belongs in the community in a special way. Even if a verse or a psalm is not my prayer, it is nevertheless the prayer of another member of the community, and it is quite certainly the prayer of the truly human Jesus Christ and his body on earth." I think of that so often too when I come across a hymn that I hate. Do you ever come across a hymn that you hate? We all do, right? And I have challenged myself, which actually happens quite frequently at the church I currently attend. Not the one I told you about, Jim. No, it's a different one. I think, what does it mean to sing this psalm, even if it's compared to this song, even if it's not where I'm at, even if it's not my favorite song, as if I'm anchoring it on my heart because it's the person's next to me favorite hymn? What does it mean when we come across a psalm? And we all do this. The liturgical, one of the gifts of the liturgical is that it presents us with a regular rhythm. But we must confess that sometimes we enter Easter and it feels like Lent in our hearts for one reason or another. And there are other times when we enter Lent and something really positive and lovely has happened in our lives. And so what we do as a community is not merely pray where we are. We also pray where our whole Christian family is across the globe. And I think the Psalms, when we come across those hard ones especially, that can be a powerful practice as a not just present in this space, but across the world. Now, of course, there are other ways we hear and pray and sing the Psalms differently. As Christians, we naturally sing the Psalms through the prism of the Paschal Mystery. That is, we hear them through the birth, life, ministry, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. For example, when we hear the words of Psalm 31, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit," we can't help but hear them in the mouth of Jesus on the cross. When we hear Psalm 118, "This is the day the Lord has made, let us rejoice and be glad," we can't help but think of the Easter season and hear those words, in those words, the celebration of the resurrection of Jesus. And when we hear Psalm 98, "All the ends of the earth have seen the saving power of God," we think of Christmas, right? When we hear "The Queen stands at your right hand arrayed in gold," no, not that one in England, we think of the Assumption of Mary. The Jewish people who prayed these Psalms originally obviously didn't have these connections that we have to them. They didn't hear these words and think of Jesus. And it's good to go back from time to time and look at their origins to uncover hidden richness we can learn from our Jewish sisters and brothers apart from our own Christian understanding. The Psalms have always been central to Jewish and Christian liturgy. And that's some of what I want to talk about as we move into our discussion about the responsorial psalm in the next portion of the evening. But one of the points I really really want to emphasize is that the Psalms can and should be an integral part of our daily prayer life as ministers in the church, not just on Sunday. When we pray the Psalms, we pray the same prayers that Jesus learned as a child and shaped his own understanding of his relationship with his Abba, Father. They are the prayers he prayed in the synagogue with his family, and they are the prayers he prayed at the hour of his death. When he cries from the cross, my God, why have you abandoned me? It is neither a moment of prayer improvisation, nor of Jesus proving how well he studied the scripture. It is the words of the prayers that accompanied him throughout his life, imprinted on his heart. And they are the prayers worth imprinting on our hearts and the hearts of our children and their children's children over a lifetime. Thomas Merton said this of the Psalms, and it's where I got the title of tonight's talk. He says, a spiritual understanding of the Psalter will not introduce us to some esoteric technique of prayer, nor will it tempt us to induce within our minds some peculiar psychological state. It will above all tell us not merely what we ought to be, but the unbelievable thing that we already are. It will tell us over and over again that we are in Christ in this world and that he lives in us. And what was said of him has been and is being fulfilled in us. And the last, most perfect fulfillment of all is now at this moment by the theological virtue of hope placed in our hands. Thus, the liturgy of earth is necessarily one with the liturgy of heaven. We are at the same time in the desert and in the promised land. The Psalms are our bread of heaven in the wilderness of our exodus. The bread of heaven in the wilderness of our exodus. This is why I think we must spend time with the Psalms to truly be ministers of the liturgy. Knowing a few musical settings is one thing. If they're japonis, it's a really good thing. Understanding them in our minds, will we do together this week is one thing. But letting them dwell richly in our hearts and in our lives is another. This is why we simply jump to what's the song for today and practice as if it's just another song in the liturgy. We miss the richness of the treasure that is the Psalms. This is one of the most profound dimensions of singing the Psalms. When they become the language of the heart, literally all of life can be sung. The trust, the praise, the comfort, but also the lament, the trembling, the anguish. Psalms provide us a language that addresses God with the whole of life. They are, in the words of one of my mentors and friends, Don Saliers, the language of the soul made audible. Whether it is out of the depths I cry to you, or make a joyful noise, or create in me a clean heart, O God, these ancient scriptural texts are speaking to us still. It is humbling to me to know that I'm fairly certain any words that I write will not be sung, probably in 30 years, and definitely not in 100 years. But there is something about the Psalms that continues to speak. The Psalms, I want to say, are given to us as discipline and as rehearsal. They discipline us to all the great themes of Scripture: creation, covenant, sin and struggle, instruction, hope, and the vision of a redeemed world. We learn to sing and pray over time even when we don't feel exactly what those texts image. That is, we might be called upon to sing a joyful psalm in a time of lament. Or we might be called upon to sing a lament in a time of joy. One of the big misunderstandings I think we have when we go to prepared liturgy is we need to remember we don't always sing how we feel, but we rehearse these words. We rehearse these images. We rehearse these feelings so that when the moments do arrive, and they inevitably will, we have words to accompany us so that when we are at the bedside of a sick parent near the end of their life, for a mother who lost her child, we have words we have rehearsed in our heart for those moments. We don't need to make something up. We have this incredible companion, which is almost always better than anything else that might leap to our minds. Like learning to play an instrument, or learning to love deeply, learning to sing the word in our lives to God takes time. Sometimes it comes naturally, and for some people it comes naturally. But often it takes a long time before the Psalms begin to sing in us. Singing the Psalms opens the emotional range of Christian faith in a much deeper way than even most of our hymnals do. Sharing Psalms, even in the simplest of musical settings, puts us in solidarity with others who also know the broken heart, the angers and the fears, as well as the unbounded joy and thanks. Such a community also begins to sense that we are actually part of the greater chorus of all of creation. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. To sing and make music, no matter how humble, is a gift. To offer everything in us and the world to God is akin to incarnation itself. And so to stand in front of an assembly or a feast and proclaim the psalm, I think demands a great deal of us. It demands that we root ourselves deeply in that book and in the whole word from which it emerges. And so I think when we go to proclaim the psalm, we should do so with a little bit of fear and trembling. Not the kind of fear and trembling that comes from not knowing the notes of the words, or being afraid of making a mistake, or of feeling inadequate to do it. But the fear and trembling that should emerge because these are the words this community needs to hear and sing today to give voice to the fullness of their faith. It's a kind of fear and trembling that's filled with a confident humility of what it means to be the one to share what we're called the bread of heaven in the wilderness of our exodus. Now, I wanted to begin with this historical and theological reflections on the Psalms because I feel like the way we think about and talk about the Psalms makes it sound as if it's just another song we sing in the liturgy. Maybe a song we pay a little more attention to because it changes week to week, or because we have a bunch of verses we need to learn for it. And I know I'm a little off topic here, but in a time when people seem to be fleeing church for a whole range of reasons, I think it's tempting to try and compete with the world around us. But one of the most significant things I think the church has to offer, even still, is it offers a place to bring our doubts, fears, and questions the rest of the world keeps so closely at bay. But when churches mirror the culture around them and try to make the liturgy ultra bright, and when we try to compete with shopping malls and concert venues, we cease to offer the full range of what this church has to offer. And while I know this isn't a workshop about evangelization, I want to suggest that part of our responsibility as ministers in the present moment is to create spaces for the full range of human emotion before God. This is why when I walk into churches trying to be more appealing by covering over the pains and doubts of life with only songs of joy or adoration, I can't help but feel we're not offering much different from the world around us. It's like add God and stir to the mania of contemporary life. But the Psalms are radical. They offer us a radically alternative vision of what we are allowed to say, sing, pray, rage to God. They tell us something different about who we are and about who God is. And I think they might be a helpful foundation for a whole way of life approaching the deepest longings of our communities, as well as those who find themselves understandably distant from God. Most of all, I think we need to remember that we need the Psalms more than God needs the Psalms. So hopefully I've convinced you to care a little bit more about the Psalms beyond the ones that are in your gap of three hymnal there in the pews or your breaking bread. But what I want to move us into now is a little bit more specificity about the songs. But I want to sing in between because a good friend of mine, Marty Hogan, his wife always says, when her eyes glaze over, sing a song.
Proclaim the reign of God and tell of God as ruler over all.
There are historical psalms that tell the history of Israel and the whole tree, like Psalm 78. And there are wisdom psalms, for like wisdom for a life well lived, like Psalm 19. So you can see how there could be an entire course on just any one genre of those psalms. But for the sake of time, just to get a sense of the common pattern they share, I want to look at three of those genres. So the first one I want to look at is the hymn of praise. And so if you open up to Psalm 8, and you could take out your phone and just Google Psalm 8 USCCB, and you'd find a perfectly good translation. Or you could Google Psalm 8 NRSV and get a good translation. Or you could Google Psalm 8 the Grail and get a good translation. But it looks like we have some old school folks with books, which is great. I love books. So, Psalm 8, Hymn of Praise, follows a very simple pattern. The beginning is an initial invitation to praise God. O Lord our God, how majestic is your name in all the earth. And then, the initial invitation to praise God, and then an extended list of reasons for the acclaim. So you see all this. Your majesty is set above the heavens, from the mouth of children and of babes. You fashion praise to quell your enemy and to silence the foe and the rebel. I realize you probably have different translations than I'm reading. But so initial invitation, and then a long list of reasons for the acclaim. And I want you to keep that in mind, a long list of reasons for the acclaim. And then it ends very simply with a final call to give praise, which often echoes the very first beginning of the psalm. One thing that often happens, so that's a typical hymn of praise, right? An invitation to praise God, a long list of reasons, and then a final call to give praise. One of the things that sometimes happens with composers is the isolation of a single phrase from a psalm out of context of the rest of it. And one very important piece of the psalms, save a couple towards the end, like 150, is that there's always a context for the praise. It's never just, O Lord our God, how majestic is your name through all the earth, repeat times often. It's always the context, always the reason for the praise. And that long, and often that reason for the praise is the longest part of the psalm. When I see the heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you arrange, who are we that you should call us to mind, the Son of God that you should care for us, all of that. And I think that context is really important when we approach the Psalms, that very 95% of the time, there's a deep reason and a context for the praise, which keeps us, I think, honest in our biblical brain of the Psalms. So let's just sing one as an example in your little lyric psalter book. Page 22, I believe it is.
Oh, Lord, our God, our Lord.
little bit to be attentive to. But for now, let's move on and take a look at the individual lament. The individual lament is, as I mentioned, the single most common genre in the Book of Psalms, but it is not the most common genre in the lectionary, which is kind of an interesting point. So lots of laments in the Book of Psalms, not so many laments that we actually hear in our Sunday lectionary. So this is the form of the individual lament. Let's take a look at Psalm 54. So, it's a typical individual lament, which begins in the first two verses with a direct address to God, calling on the name of the Lord. Save me, O God, by your name, and vindicate me by your might. Hear my prayer, O God, give ear to the words of my mouth. Then, in verse 3, an account of the troubles of the one calling. For the insolent have risen against me, and the ruthless seek my life. They do not set God before them. And then in verse 4, a request for divine assistance, because human assistance is insufficient. But surely God is my helper, the Lord is the upholder of my life. Often followed by an expression of trust, and an expression of desire for intervention. And then often, an individual lament concludes, as you can see in verse 7 there, with an expression of praise for what God has done in the past, and will the psalmist hopes do now. For he has in the past delivered me from every trouble, and my eye has looked in triumph on my enemies. So you see that form very commonly in an individual lament. Once again, a direct address to God, an account of the troubles of the one calling, a request for assistance, often followed by an expression of trust in God's intervention, and then often concluded with an expression of praise for what God has done in the past. Let's sing one of these. This doesn't appear in your C, so you're just going to have to listen and respond, which you seem to be really good at. Psalm 116. So Psalm 116, or Thanksgiving Psalm in general, and you can see it here in Psalm 116, begins with a word of gratitude to God in the first two verses. I love the Lord because he has heard my voice in supplication. Because he inclined his ear to me, therefore I will call on him as long as I live. Followed by, in verse 3, an account of the state of the affairs from which the psalmist has been delivered. The snares of death encompassed me. The pangs of Sheol laid hold on me. I suffered distress and anguish. And then a very long acknowledgement of the divine interaction that has brought about blessing for the psalmist. And then finally, like the psalm of praise that we looked at earlier, a call for the others to join in the psalmist's deliverance. Now, of course, I don't expect you to remember all of these shapes and all of these categories. Why do I share this with you? Well, I think it's helpful to know that there is a pattern to these psalms, that they're not just simply a mishmash of phrases, which sometimes our lecture can unfortunately make it seem by its kind of slicing and dicing. I think it's important that we know that shape. But I think, more importantly, a key part of being a servant of the liturgy, and I really see that as our work, all of us, whether our ministry is in music, catechesis, presiding, hospitality, the one we all share together, that we have a responsibility to be servants of the Word of God in its fullness, as it is proclaimed week to week, season by season, year to year. I think we don't need to just know the rhythm of the lectionary, but we also need to pray with it, learn a bit about it, attempt to understand the scriptures and their history, and be attentive to the emerging patterns over the course of Sundays. Our proclamation of the Word, our singing of the Word, our preaching of the Word, all of these can be powerful tools for good, and we must confess also for ill. And music, both the choice of the psalm setting and the way it's executed, can shape, enhance, and distort the meaning. Anyone who has been moved when listening to a symphony or sung or sorrow through a cello concerto or his joy through a piano prelude knows what music can do to words. Even one word can express more than 1,000 spoken. The most obvious example is Handel's Hallelujah Chorus. How could the joy of singing Hallelujah dozens of times by high voices, low voices, and all voices together, quickly, slowly, softly, loudly, ever be captured by merely speaking that word? But because of this power that music has, music can literally alter the meaning of a scriptural text, or even subvert its meaning as much as it can enrich it. We don't need to be biblical scholars to take a few minutes to consider the shape of a psalm, and how our music and how our leadership of that psalm might express it. Especially, by the way, those of us with the power to write music, and those of us with the power to select the music that our communities will sing. I think, for example, of the musical danger that can emerge when musicians only look at the psalm antiphon for a particular Sunday and base the music on their sense of that one line. You know what I'm saying? The refrain that's repeated can sometimes give a mistaken impression of what the fullness of the psalm is. And I'll give you one example of Psalm 90, one of my favorite psalms, a lament, beginning with an admission of the brevity of human life, then telling about the way in which our lives fade away because of sin. Then it moves into a petitionary lament, asking God to restore joy. And I think of some beautiful settings of this, like In Every Age by Jeanette Whitaker, or Bernadette Farrell's Restless is the Heart, that's a more kind of choral version of it, which captures the psalm so beautifully. But in the lectionary, it's paired with a bunch of different antiphons, and one is, fill us with your love, O God, and we will sing for joy. And if you only base your entire understanding of that psalm on that phrase, you might think it's a psalm of praise, actually. And you as a composer, if you have done your homework, might write something like, fill us with your love, O joy, and we will sing for joy. Let's keep joking. Except your phone is saying, wrote that too. But if you consider the psalm in its fullness, you're going to realize that fill us with your love, O God, and we will sing for joy, is only an excerpt of what the fullness of the song means. So if you don't know that, you as a musician could easily subvert the fullness of the meaning of the song. If you don't know that as someone who leads it, you might stand up there and say, "Fill us with your love, Lord, and we will sing for joy." When really it's a song of lament. It's a song of trying to sing the psalmist back into hope. One that I wrote, Psalm 126, setting up, "The Lord has done great things for us and we are filled with joy." It's really about trying to remember what God did in the past and hoping it will be made present now. It's not the full, I won't go into all exegesis, but it's not the full like, joyful image you might have by just hearing that one antiphon. And so I think we need to take this responsibility a little more seriously than we do at times. We are merely on the lookout for tunes that we like, or even only tunes that are just singable, though I really hope they are. Our service to the Word demands more of us than that. We have a responsibility to do what Paul says, "Let the Word of God dwell in us richly." And of course, my aim here is not to pick on particular people or songs. We who do this work, and I first among all, constantly fall short. Trust me, when you start writing music when you're 19, you constantly have evidence of things you did not know what you were doing. But I think part of our work is discernment of the Word in relation to the fullness of its context. And I think we need to pay attention also. It's always 8 o'clock when I start to start my speech, and they can tell you, I didn't even have a drink, I had a Diet Coke. I used to teach this class from 6 to 9. Tuesday nights. It was always like right at 8 o'clock. It'd be like, "Has the professor been drinking again?" But I think there's another reason to pay attention to the Psalms. And that's that they teach us how to pray as individuals and as community. They inform us in how we pray privately and publicly. Rather than just making something up from scratch, praying the Psalms can show us the elements of a prayer. Spending a little more time than I had time to do tonight on the different parts of a psalm can be a really good guide for how we might pray in our daily living. And when we have no other words in times of difficulties or joy, the psalms can be an immense help. So these are some brief thoughts on the theology of the Psalter. I just want to talk a little bit about the specific nature of the responsorial psalm now. Let's look at number 34, by page 34, I believe, near the earlier Psalter. Is that your words, Lord, our spirit and life? Well, that went well. Guiding document that I know all of you have read multiple times says this about responsorial psalm. The responsorial psalm follows the first reading. Because it is an integral part of the liturgy of the word and is in effect a reading from Scripture, it has great liturgical and pastoral significance. Corresponding to the reading that it follows, the responsorial psalm is intended to foster meditation on the Word of God. Its musical setting should aid this, being careful not to overshadow the other readings. This is, of course, why we sing the psalms from King Ambo, because it's not just another psalm. It is a crucial part of the liturgy of the Word. When those of us who lead the psalm approach the Ambo, it's a different role other parts of the liturgy. We are actually proclaiming Scripture. This gets a little lost sometimes when the psalm never receives any attention in the preaching. When we only hear about the first gospel, maybe the second reading, rarely do we hear the psalm preached on. But it is indeed one of the sources to which the preacher should be attentive as well. I think that holds great promise for our community's understanding and depth of the psalms when they hear it preached on, rather than seeing it merely as a musical interlude between the scriptures that never gets talked about anywhere else in the liturgy. And there are so many opportunities for preaching the psalms. Another crucial note from Sing to the Lord. Because the psalm is properly a form of sung prayer, every means available in each individual culture is to be employed in fostering the singing of the psalm. That's strong language. Every means available in each individual culture is to be employed in fostering the singing of the psalms. And this is why I think Sing to the Lord provides the option for seasonal psalms, because in some communities that might be a step on the way. Really nothing should stop us from singing the psalms. I find it so funny when people say, well, we can't sing in my community because we don't have anyone that plays the organ or the piano or the guitar or whatever. And then I look at people across the world in lesser developed countries than ours with absolutely nothing, and they're singing, right? Music hasn't become this kind of like commodity that's done. It's something everyone does no matter what. And Sing to the Lord is calling us, even in simple circumstances, to find a simple setting to sing those songs. That's how important it is. So now I want to share this crash course. You doing okay? I want to share some questions, confusions, clarifications about the psalms and their translation. As you no doubt know, there are many, many English translations of the Bible. In fact, probably many here among the Bibles that are here tonight, and if you use your digital device, many, many more available to you in the palm of your hands. In our current lectionary, if you open to a Sunday or a solemnity and look at the Psalm translation, it has been taken for the last several decades from the New American Bible, NAB. That has been the official translation. A few years ago, the USCCB, with Rome's permission, made a change. This made another translation the official Psalter. The Grail Psalter. Have you heard of this? The Grail Psalter, a different translation. And the idea is that in the future publications of the lectionary, the Grail will replace the NAB. So for the moment, both are considered official liturgical texts, but eventually the NAB will be, in theory, phased out. But what's really confusing about all this is, if you're not already confused, is the official nature of the text is less important because the USCCB actually permits Psalm paraphrases. So, unlike the Roman Missal, where we're required to use the text exactly as they are, we can't, for example, David Hossie's Ave Gloria, sing glory to God, we can't even say sing anymore. Not that we ever really could have, but anyway. We definitely can. But in the case of the Psalter, we can use paraphrases. This is a little strange, because that means as long as someone calls something a paraphrase of a psalm, it's considered listed. So to take a popular example, Psalm 23, the antiphon is, "The Lord is my shepherd, there is nothing I shall want." Marty Huggin adapted that pretty significantly when he wrote, "Shepherd me, O God, beyond my wants, beyond my fears, from death into life." Technically, Marty's setting is licit as a responsorial psalm, and good people can debate whether it's appropriate or not. However, I would suggest it's probably placed better at different points in the liturgy. There has been a trend, however, in probably the last 5 or so years, towards being more faithful to the official texts. So you see resources like Respond and Acclaim from OCP, or Cry Out with Joy, or the Gimel Psalter, or the Lyric Psalter, which Marty and I did from GIA. These are the official texts rather than adaptations. So they are, I would say, more faithful to the original intent of the psalm, and there's less risk of singing something that might skew the meaning in the hands of the composer. For all the church's liturgical control, it's somewhat surprising to me that adaptations are still allowed. And don't get me wrong, I still use them from time to time, but my own preference would be to use the official texts for the most part. And I think this is a trend in many dioceses and churches. It's why we did the Lyric Psalter for that reason. Does that make sense what I'm saying? So you're allowed to use paraphrases. I mean, your bishop could say you're not allowed to use paraphrases. I don't know what the case is here. Are you allowed to use them?
Sure.
Sure? Yeah. Did you just make yourself a bishop now?
He thinks so.
But in some dioceses, which I'll go to and like prepare a mass for an ass liturgy, they will say, no, we have to use the official text. So there's a move towards that. And I have to say, I lean towards that. And part of the reason I lean toward it is because a lot of composers have gotten fast and loose with their paraphrases. So much so that not only are there maybe additions of phrases, but omissions of key phrases, because the music is driving the text rather than the text driving the music. I think we've gotten better over time. But when you have no one kind of overseeing that, and someone's written, I mean, this is tempting to me all the time, and this is what made doing the Lyric Psalter so difficult and made me realize why people use chanting tones. Because when you write kind of like an 8 or a 16 measure phrase, and then all of a sudden one of the verses of the psalm goes on and on and on and on, it can be tempting, and from a musical standpoint, to just be like, oh, let's just lop off those lines and just make it fit my musical pattern. But that's letting the music drive the meaning of the song rather than being faithful to the song. So I've kind of grown to be a little bit more in favor of official texts. So that's a little word about translations. Now, the reason for the choice of psalms in the lectionary and the antiphons and verses as they are, I began a little while ago talking about the shape of the psalms, right? We took out our Bibles, we looked at them, we saw different patterns. But what we sing on Sunday as the responsorial psalm is not usually, in fact, the entire psalm, but excerpts from a particular psalm paired with a particular antiphon that usually, but doesn't always, appear in the psalm itself. Like one particular example of an antiphon that doesn't appear in Psalm 96 is, "Today is born our Savior Christ the Lord," which of course would not appear in a Jewish psalter. So both the antiphon and the verses are specifically chosen because of their key connections with the first reading of the gospel. So for example, Psalm 22 is the appointed psalm for Passion Sunday because we hear Jesus quote the phrase, my God, why have you abandoned me?" That's the appointed antiphon. Whereas in another place where Psalm 22 appears in the lectionary, the refrain is, "I will praise you, Lord, in the assembly of your people," but it's still Psalm 22. But what's important for you to remember about all this is that both the antiphon slash refrain and the verses are specifically chosen for a particular Sunday or feast. Now, since Vatican II, how this happens in liturgy has been a little sloppy in actual practice. So even though both the antiphon and the verses can be completely different, they can have profoundly different meanings. And I blame some of my dear friends and colleagues who themselves would confess this, who wrote many, many editions of psalms for the church here, right? Without deep attentiveness to those connections between the particularities and the verses that are prescribed for a particular Sunday. So to put this on the ground, let's take a look at Psalm 104 in its many forms, since we are about to sing it this weekend. So if you go to the USCCB readings page, you'll notice that the Pentecost setting of Psalm 104, here are the verses. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O Lord my God, you are great indeed. How many are your works, O God, the earth is full of your creatures. That is also the same first verse that's prescribed for the Easter Vigil, the first psalm of the Easter Vigil. But then, the psalms for the Easter Vigil, the other verses are very different. These are the verses for the Easter Vigil. You fix the earth upon its foundation, not to be moved forever. With the ocean as with the garment you covered it. Above the mountains the waters stood. You sent forth springs into their water courses that wind among the mountains. Beside that the birds of heaven dwell. From among the branches they sent forth their song. You water the mountains from your palace. The earth is replete with the fruit of your works. You raise grass for the cattle and vegetation for man's use, producing bread for the earth. How many are your works, O Lord, and wisdom you have wrought them all. The earth is full of your creatures. Now, none of those words are the words prescribed for Pentecost, even though the psalm is the same, Psalm 104. Why do you suppose those particular words are chosen for the Easter Vigil? Let me read a little bit of it. Think of its context. Does anyone know where 104 falls in the Easter Vigil? First, following the light. You fix the earth upon its foundation, not to be moved forever. With the ocean as with a garment you covered it, above the mountains the waters stood. You send forth springs into their water courses that wind among the mountains. So you hear all of that gorgeous creation imagery present in the assigned verses for the Easter Vigil. Of course, because it follows the Genesis reading of creation, right? So it's a perfect example of why particular verses are chosen to correspond with a particular scripture. And if we simply go and we look for any old setting of Psalm 104, we might miss out on all of that beautiful connection and imagery that's very intentionally placed there. Versus Pentecost, which does not use all of that beautiful creation imagery. So let me just sing one that has all of those visual verses. This is Send Forth Your Spirit, Mark Haugen song. It's a continuation of it. My family and I don't go to church to deny the existence of darkness. We go to look so hard at the light that our eyes water. I think singing the songs in their fullness give us such a grammar for a darkness and light that makes our eyes water. In a culture of immediacy and forgetfulness and checklists that always move us on to the next thing, taking up the Psalms not just as something we sing between the two readings on Sunday, but as a way of life, I think is a way of embracing both the darkness and the light and calling them both good. It is part of cooperating with what Teilhard de Chardin calls the slow work of God, a slow work that inscribes words deeply on the lives of our community, rehearsing them and rehearsing us in vocabulary we may not need in the present moment, but may well need in the future. Rehearsing us in a vocabulary that the person next to us whose pain we will never know may need more than we do in that moment. Rehearsing us in joy even when it seems distant. Singing the Psalms is a practice that invites us to sing what is most true about ourselves and our world. It invites those of us who discern the words and notes we place in the hearts of our communities to contemplate the gaps in our own repertoire, because those gaps aren't just musical ones, they're theological ones as well. Ones that tell those in our care whether the fullness of who they are, including and perhaps especially if their wounds, our wounds are given a voice, and the Psalms give us that permission. Thank you so much.
Because we'd like to ask you to join us for some koinonia, some fellowship, and
I didn't thank our special thanks to Debbie Kostoski, Gene Forrish, and John Hahn, and the staff from Campus Ministry.